So does anybody recognise that bit of historical footage there?
Charge the Light Brigade.
That's right. Charge the Light Brigade, 1854, Battle of the Balaclava. It didn't go too well. It was in fact a specification error. This is the written order received by Lucan and Nolan. Lord Raglan wishes the cavalry to advance rapidly to the front, follow the enemy, and try to prevent the enemy carrying away the guns, which was perfectly clear to Lord Raglan. What Lord Raglan knew from his position was that the Turkish position on Causeway side had been overrun by the Russians in the Battle of Crimea, and they were in danger of carrying away the artillery. He wanted cavalry to harry them and try and prevent that happening. From the position of the Light Brigade, they didn't see that. They just said, move to the guns. And there was some bad blood, there was misunderstandings. And what happened was that the Light Brigade charged entrenched artillery and was decimated. Not kind of area you want to avoid, especially in your code, I guess. Could maybe rephrase that? As Army Commander, Lord Raglan wants the cavalry to engage the enemy that have captured the redoubts on Causeway Heights so that the naval guns will not be carried away by the enemy. Key point there is that we have some acceptance criteria. If we explain the reasoning behind something, it makes it easier to understand the order, what we're trying to carry out. In fact, the US Army have a regulation, I believe, that the reasoning behind any order ought to be included in the order to avoid ambiguity, and also if for whatever reason the original order can be carried out so that something equivalent can be done. So that the commander on the ground can reason about it. Here would have some acceptance criteria which might have helped Lucan and Nolan to avoid charging an entrenched code position. Note the key one though, that one of the consistent criteria might be the Light Brigade would not be destroyed. I don't believe Raglan actually wrote any Cucumber tests even after this. But this kind of reasoning, including acceptance criteria, giving examples of what will be successful, is something that we've come to embrace. Years ago, I was writing some software for a Norwegian railway. It was ticketing software. And one of the things I had to do was to write the code behind to deal with monthly season tickets. We seemed quite straightforward until I started to think about it. And it wasn't clear to me some details of how monthly season tickets worked. Just that both fact doesn't give me enough information, because maybe I don't know enough about railways or season tickets, or maybe I'm a bit thick. These are the kind of questions I had. Do you mean a calendar month? What exactly do you mean by calendar month? Really, if I buy a ticket last day of the month, does that really happen? So, one of the things we can do is to try and specify, try and explain the algorithms behind this. But it is much simpler just to reason with examples, such as that one. With Cucumber, with Fit Cucumber, we We can turn these examples into executable examples, into tests we can execute into code. And that is fantastic. We've got a test, we've got documentation, and the customer can read that. Absolutely brilliant. And yes, well done, Cucumber. So we start off with this. We start off having these fantastic experiences. We can put our examples in front of the customer. We can come to agreements. Onwards to the march of the acceptance tests. The team loves them. Going forward with them. Of course, after a while, maybe the tests start to take a little while to run. Maybe we don't have such a quick build. And we start to get to the point where every time we had a new feature, there's a little bit of test break, and we may be spending more and more time. Spending more and more time dealing with rewriting tests rather than actually production code. Coupled with the long feedback loops, maybe the build starts to break more often. We see red in the build. A bit dispiriting, perhaps. But these changes are quite gradual. Anyone heard of Boiling the Frog? That's everybody. I'll explain it anyway. It's a myth, really, I believe. But the story is that if you put a frog in cold water and heat the water very, very gradually, because the changes are so gradual, the frog doesn't notice the change in temperature, and the frog will just stay in the water and eventually be boiled. I haven't tried it. I gave a dry run with this talk at the Scottish Ruby user group, and somebody said that they were going to try it. I tried to discourage them. So these changes are quite gradual. Perhaps it's more obvious to people who join the team afresh, or that's happened quite often to me. The inherited code, which is heavily accepted, heavily cucumbered, which is a term I just made up, fantastic. Heavily cucumbered code, inherited, you're not being boiled gradually, it becomes more obvious then. But either way, as things get worse and worse, quite often the team abandons the acceptance testing suite. There's actual footage of a team abandoning an acceptance testing suite. It's quite a rare photograph. But how did we get to this state? It started off so great. Remember the high five? It was brilliant. There was a bit of a discussion on the London Ruby user group, which I work on, and somebody talked about the honeymoon period of acceptance testing. What went wrong? Things started off so good. You can actually see, but there's not actually unicorns, but there's ponies down there. Which brings to the title of the talk. A few years ago, Ted Neward wrote an essay calling Object Relational Mapping the Vietnam of Computer Science. And the nub of the essay was that Early successes encourage you to put more and more resources into a system, and there is a reduction in the value we're getting back. It's called the law of diminishing returns. So the early successes lure you into putting more and more effort. So there's also the last mile problem. you've got these, you're doing so well, but you want to finish the job. I was having a Joe Bryan's talk earlier, and he talked about the need for closure. But there's something in that. So Ted Neward was arguing that in the case of observational mapping, that there's early successes, you get a good mapping between tables and classes. But the last mile is a difficult one. That's what kills object relational mapping, trying to complete the last thing. In fact, I suspect that's one of the reasons that Rails became successful, in that Active Record doesn't try and complete the last mile. It doesn't try and be an object relational mapping tool for every database, for every. If you're not following the Rails, you know, Rails standard, ID fields, lowercase underscore, sure you can kind of put it in there, but it's not optimal. It's not making that last effort, and there's a reduction in complexity because of that. I feel the same thing's happening with acceptance testing. There's these early successes, and that brings us in. We put more and more effort into trying to accept and assess everything, and there's a reduction in effort. In fact, I think it's probably more like this. But that's total effort, so it's the effort including in maintaining the existing tests. I used to be a marine biologist, and there's a very similar graph for fishing effort in a system. The more fishing effort is put into a system, the less and less catch you get out of it. The acceptance testing, the European Common Fishing Areas policy of testing and development would have been a sort of catchier talk title then. So what can we do about this? How can we maintain our happy pony, beautiful initial feeling of high fives with the acceptance testing? Well, there's two things we can do. We can know when to stop. And the other thing we can do is try and push this curve to the left so that we get more volume with less effort. Thank you. How do we achieve this? Well, let's take a look at what we're trying to achieve with acceptance testing. And there are two candidate things we're trying to achieve. We're trying to achieve documentation and verification. As for documentation, ladies and gentlemen, I'll give you the Agile Manifesto. Where we value working software over comprehensive documentation. It's not that documentation isn't valuable, it's just that working software is more important. And we need to bear that in mind, I would say. The key there is comprehensive documentation. One of the things I would say we should jettison is trying to document everything through acceptance testing, which I've seen a lot of. This kind of thing. If you have a shopping cart in a system and we add an item to the shopping cart, we buy something, then there's an item in the shopping cart. I don't think that is valuable to documentation, I think that's just bloody obvious. There may be value for verification, but I'll get to that later. But for documentation purposes, that's not good. That's inventory, it's waste in the system. You've got to maintain that. Whether it's complicated business logic or difficult to understand business logic or less obvious business logic, I think there's a case. There's a case for documenting that. And given that, there's a case for documenting that with acceptance tests, so that your code actually verifies the documentation. A good example is the season, monthly season ticket, if the programmer is maybe a bit confused about what a monthly season ticket actually is, it's good to have that there. If you've ever worked in financial software dealing with exotic instruments, that's a very good place for having this kind of documentation in a system. So verification. I think we have an existing tool for verification, and that's our unit tests. We don't need to do these in the acceptance test. I believe what they ought to be about. Acceptance tests are about clarification. Somebody fancy you can pop them next door on the phone or something. Anyway, what was I saying? This is an argument that was given quite strongly by Jeff Patton, who is a well-known XP Agile person, and also used to be the maintainer of not Jeff Patton, Jim Shaw. Was that your question?
Yeah.
Okay. The comment was that while it may not be good useful as documentation, that a shopping cart contains an item that has just been added to it, as a test for verification purposes, that is valuable. And what I would say to that is that we do have tools for that, such as our test-driven development tools, our TDD, our unit tests. I think that is the appropriate point which to verify. There's no need to bother the customer with that, I would say.
So who's writing it? And it's important to the customer about specifying that empty card, then it makes sense to express it at their level. The unit test is obviously given from them, they have no visibility of it. So how do you balance that?
You can balance. If it's important for the customer, how do we give visibility for the customer? There is on-site customer. There's demonstrations. There's examples. You can walk through the customer, and I would say that it's an obvious feature that something goes into a shopping cart. There's a balance here, and what I'm suggesting that we do is to be pruning out the less important, the less valuable tests, so that we can stop at that point on the curve. Because everything we write in the system needs to be maintained. My experience of some acceptance projects, with some projects with acceptance tests, one of the problems is there are just simply too many of them that aren't adding any value. So given that we've jettisoned acceptance tests which are there for verification purposes only, or less value for documentation, how can we get more value out of the remaining tests? Acceptance tests, as currently commonly practiced, are, in my experience, in the Ruby community at least, with Cucumber, tend to be full stack. It's actually quite true in the earlier times with Java and Fit that people did often make them full stack. Except, I don't believe, acceptance tests aren't the same as end-to-end tests. Acceptance tests I would say, or for clarification, and for clarification, they don't need to be end-to-end. There's a quote about programming VI, which was, it's like changing the sheets in a hotel room by sticking a bent coat hanger in through the keyhole. I thought that also applied to end-to-end acceptance tests. If the logic's in the model, why not test the model? Why not we can test it at that point? Before Cunningham had a phrase about acceptance testing under the glass. So you acceptance testing underneath the presentation tier. If we do Rails, we're not that layered, so we tend not to have tiers in such a same way. Everything's in the presentation tier, but I did find when doing acceptance tests in Java with Fit and giving a separate client for the domain actually made the definition of the domain quite neat. It made sure that the presentation logic was kept quite separate. It helped a lot with that. So we can test at that level, or even better, skip the database and test around the model. So write the acceptance tests around the piece of code which encapsulates the logic you're testing. You're verifying, documenting even. If you can't find a piece of code which encapsulates that, perhaps that's an indication that the code spread too thinly throughout the system. This is kind of an example of an acceptance test written in terms of the front end. So we've got this fairly complicated feature about applying discounts to books. It's a Harry Potter series, and if somebody buys two books in the series, they get discounts, but they don't get a discount to buy the same book. If we try and express this through the front end, it ends up being very, very difficult to separate the actual logic that we're trying to describe from just a cruft of navigating around the front end. And that's even without talking about CSS selectors. That's not in that code, but it's still quite nasty. If we just define it in terms of the business logic, everything is much clearer. And it also means that it makes it easier to plug this in at any level. You could equally plug that in and run it through WebRat if you wanted to. That's why I say you should at least be able to plug. The test definition should be agnostic of where it's plugged into the system. Another thing which can happen quite with acceptance testing is that acceptance tests are built around user stories. So an acceptance test is created for a user story, and these accumulate in the system. Jeff Patton, not Jim Shaw, Jeff Patton is an agile product person, and in his description of, it isn't like defining things in straight backlogs, stories in straight backlogs. As when he's talking about defining the system, he talks about, he feels he's talked to the clients and they've produced this lovely map of the system with it's like a tree and the trunks of the users and the leaves or the features. They take all these off, they chop down the tree, and a backlog is just a big bag of mulch. if we're organizing our tests in terms of user stories, we have a set of documentation which is just a big bag of mulch. Example, let's say we, it's a naive example of recognizing a credit card type for by the number. So initially we're accepting Visa and MasterCard and we recognize the type from the number. Yeah, no, they're not valid credit card numbers. Later on we had a story to support American Express. If we add this as a new acceptance test, for one thing the previous test is failing, for another thing we're spreading information about this throughout our system. It's a reasonably common way of doing things, I've found. I don't like it. There's people have putting extensions into Jira, things like that, through to add acceptance tests. Much better to define them in terms of features of the system and modify the acceptance tests at that level. So we've, I believe, identified a good point to cut off putting effort into excellence test and ways to move the value to the left. Being acceptance test. In summary, we write tests that clarify difficult, only write tests which clarify difficult domain rules. Write tests in terms of the domain, not the user interface. And organize the tests around domain themes. That's all, folks. My name's Paul Wilson. Come to the Scottish RubyConf Conference.